We have understood that Bhagavan comes and self-manifests only in the body of Arjuna, and nobody knows who Arjuna is, who Bhagavan is, until Bhagavan himself gives the complete details of himself as well as Arjuna. Now we will look at the evidences that Arjuna alone sees the God. None in this world can see the God the way Arjuna sees. In the verse 5 of chapter 4, God mentions that, O Arjuna, innumerable births in the innumerable cycles of me in the form of God and you have passed away. I know them, you don't. Which means every end of Iron Age, Bhagavan comes and self-manifests in the body of the Arjuna to establish Dharma so that the new cycle begins. This is not known to Arjuna. Arjuna says, whatever you are telling me, I accept all that to be true, because, O God, neither the deities nor the demons know your revealed form. The deities exist in the golden and silver age of the heaven, the Devalok, and the demons are there in the Dwapara and Kali Yuga, or the copper and iron age of the demonic world. And Arjuna says that no one in these two worlds knows your revealed form. And thus, when you have come and self-manifested in me, that is only when you tell me the truth and I do accept whatever you are telling me to be true. And thus, in 1144, Arjuna says, that is why, while completely offering my body and being very humble, I please you, the Lord, who is worth being praised, O Mahadeva. Now, Arjuna has understood what he is expected of from the God, and he has understood the importance of his body being the chariot of God. And thus, he completely surrenders his body to the service of Yajna, of fire of knowledge of God. As said in 14th verse of 10, during the Devalok and Asurlok, none know Bhagavan. Because in the second verse of chapter 10, Bhagavan says that my divine birth happens even before the Devatas and the Maharshis. Maharshis are the people who have written all the scriptures in all the religions, and Devatas are the happy souls that enjoy their life during the heaven period. And God says that my divine birth happens even before the Devatas. That would obviously be at the end of previous Iron Age. Hence, Bhagavan is revealing about his form to Arjuna alone. The same is confirmed in Gita verse 1147 and 1148. In the 48th verse of chapter 11, Bhagavan says, O brave one of the Kuru, the doer clan, me, the supreme intellect with intellectually perceivable form, neither through Vedas, Yajnas, the self-study, nor through donations, neither through the acts of rituals, nor through strict physical intense meditation, no one except you in this human world is capable to see. It clearly means that no one actually sees the way Arjuna sees, because the auspicious intellect, Bhagavan, the soul, supreme soul, is sitting inside his body. So the way he sees him, the way he understands the knowledge, no one can see the form of God in that way. In the verse 43 of 11, Arjuna is praising Bhagavan, stating that you are the seed form father of this living and inert world and the best worship worthy guru, meaning the true world guru, Jagat Guru, or the Vishwa Guru, because God comes and self-manifests to teach the Dharma only at the end of the world, when everybody is here on earth. So he is called Vishwaguru and the only one who knows the true knowledge, hence the Sadguru of this world. Oh, the one with incomparable influence, certainly there is no one equal to you in all the three worlds, Brahmaloka, heaven and hell. Then how will there be anyone else greater than you? The three worlds are, we already know the two worlds, the heaven and hell. And the third world is when Bhagavan comes in the last few years at the end of the Iron Age and teaches the knowledge of becoming right here, that period, that short period, is called Brahmaloka, because Param Brahma, the Supreme Guru, is teaching that knowledge and the entire world learns this knowledge. Hence called Brahmaloka. Brahma means the biggest abode. Before we proceed, let's have a short recap of the nouns that we have derived from the following verses in our previous episode number 7 of this series 1. In these three verses, God called his form metaphorically as light, jyoti, comparing to that of the sun. He is the sun of knowledge. Unlike us human souls, he is ever unborn. Thus, he is addressed as Purushottama, meaning Supreme Soul in Sanskrit. Therefore, to sermonize the knowledge, he self-manifests in the bodily chariot of Arjuna. The body in Sanskrit is called Linga. Thus, it is appropriate to call Bhagavan as Jyotirlinga. In verse number 19 of 11, he is called Suryanetra. Surya is the sun of knowledge, of course, and Netra means leader in Sanskrit, the one who is leading the bodily chariot of Arjuna. As we can clearly see from the picture of Gita, where Bhagavan has taken control of the bodily chariot of Arjuna. And as mentioned in verse number 19 of 11, God burns the entire Vishwa, meaning the entire population of end of Iron Age world, with his radiance in the form of blazing fire of knowledge coming out of his mouth, from the mouth that is part of Arjuna's body. Hence, Arjuna is appropriately addressed as Bharata. The meaning of the word Bharata we will see in the following episodes. In verse 4 of chapter 8, Bhagavan addresses Arjuna as Dehabhratam Vara, meaning the best of the bodily beings. Now, one should think that of all the 700 verses, why Bhagavan has addressed Arjuna only once as Dehabhratam Vara in this verse? It is because Bhagavan says, I am the Lord of the Yajna in this body of you, who is the best of the bodily being, Arjuna. So it is clear that Bhagavan is unipresent in the bodily chariot of Arjuna alone. As the Gita picture also shows that Bhagavan rides or drives only Arjuna's chariot. It is the greatest mistake by scholars to have interpreted that God resides in all, whereas it was his radiance of knowledge that reaches all. In verse numbers 6 and 7 of chapter 4, he clearly mentioned that he is Swayambhava and Swayambhu, as we have already proven in the previous episode. And in verse number 18 of chapter 9, he mentioned that he is the master of the three tasks of A-Uma. Hence, it is appropriate to call him Omkarnath, Omkareshwar, Ek Omkar. And in these two verses, he called himself the knower of heavenly knowledge. Hence, he will be called as Amarnath. And he burns the entire world or Vishwa with his radiance to create heaven on this earth. Hence, he will be called as Vishwanath. And he is addressed as Devadeva in this verse, which in Sanskrit would be Mahadev. In verse number 12 of chapter 10, he mentioned about himself to be Vibhu, meaning special manifestation or Vibhuti, yet remains detached from the body. Thus, he may be rightly called as Vairagi in Sanskrit. From these two verses, 11 of 9 and 54 of chapter 11, it is understood that God cannot be recognized by the physical eyes just by looking at his bodily chariot. He is recognized by the eye of knowledge, that is intellectual understanding. Thus, Gita verses mention about Jnana Chakshu. The name of the knowledge is Rajavidya or Adhyatmavidya. The Rajavidya and the word Adhyatmavidya clearly mean that this is most confidential knowledge and transforms the human soul into a royal or king-like, relieving the soul from enslavement of bodily desires to become in the image of God. Verse number 2 of chapter 14 states that after taking the support of this knowledge, that is Rajavidya or Adhyatma Vidya, who have attained the characteristics of viceless and egoless Parambrahma like me, are not born in this sorrowful world, which obviously means that their mind is completely disengaged from this Iron Age worldly affairs. And they don't become distressed in the great destruction at the end of the pralaya, which means dissolution of the world either. One may question, when the supreme power Bhagwan has come, why is the destruction needed? Why is pralaya needed? We understood that Bhagwan is auspicious intellect. He possesses the knowledge of Uma, the creation of the new mindset, that is the righteous mindset, and the maintenance of the righteous people and the destruction of the iron-aged unrighteous people with divided clashing opinions who are called asuras, the demons. God does not perform any miracles. God is like the sun who gives light to all in an unbiased manner, but the freedom to expose one's self to sunlight, meaning the light of knowledge, lies with the individual human being's will. Thus, when God comes to establish dharma, that is the righteousness in this world at the end of the Iron Age, as said in verse number 7 of 4, the immediate next verse mentions that for the safety of the pious ones, the sadhus, the evildoers are destroyed. Sanskrit meaning of the word sadhus are given here because sadhu has been interpreted by the scholars as the saints and sannyasis, whereas the sadhus are the ones who do sadhana, meaning the spiritual effort of controlling their senses, which can be done only through the knowledge of righteousness being imparted by God. Hence, the meaning of the sadhus is the righteous ones, meaning the immortal deities, who are called as Pandavas in the Gita, and the evildoers are called as Kauravas and Yadavas. Hence, the destroyer is Arjuna. However, it is known that Hindu scriptures mention that the task of destruction is that of Rudra. Under the auspicious knowledge of Bhagavan, it is Arjuna who accomplishes this beneficial task of pralaya, meaning destruction, yet remains sinless, which will be discussed in the next episode. The word yuge yuge in this verse is misinterpreted as God comes in all four yugas. Whereas when we study the word yuge yuge with proper evidences, it indicates the end of the Iron Age. Please see series 2 for all the proofs. The Pralayankar, meaning the destroyer, who dissolves this Iron Age world for the establishment of the new Golden Age world, has been called as Agni in the Mahabharata Stri Parva chapter 21, verse number 1 to 14, and is called Rudra or Kala or Mahakala or the Kalpantakari in the Gita, Rudrashtakam and the Rigveda. This proves that Arjuna is Rudra. Let's see the following two verses from the Rig Veda to get a clarity if Arjuna is Rudra, who Bhagavan is. Verse from Rig Veda says, Rudra by day, Rudra at night, we honor with these songs the universe's father. So Rudra has been termed as the universe's father, meaning Arjuna has been called or praised as the universe's father. And in another verse of Rig Veda, he has been praised with humble adoration, show this day your song of praise to mighty Rudra, ruler of the brave, with whom the eager ones going their ordered course. Shiva comes from divinely abode, self-bright, auspicious, strong to guard. So again here, two souls have been praised. The Rudra, who is the ruler of the brave, with whom the eager ones going their ordered course. Meaning those people who want to become deities would follow the Rudra. And Shiva comes from divinely abode, self-bright, auspicious, strong to guard. So Shiva is the guard to Rudra. Let's know more about the relationship between Shiva and Rudra. Because Rudra is always shown as the three-eyed personality. There's only one deity among the 330 million deities who is shown with the three eyes. The mystery behind three eyes will open up the relationship between Shiva and
The Rudra.
The mystery behind the three eyes of Rudra. The three-eyed Rudra is the Swayambhu. As you can see, the meaning of the Swayambhu is independent, self-existing, the Shiva, and Shiva Shankar Mahadev is popularly called as Shambho Shiva Shankar Mahadev. Shambho is correct form of the word Swayambhu. And the third eye in the three-eyed Swayambhu is called as Shivanetra. It is only Mahadev among all the 330 million deities who is shown with the third eye and is called as Trinetra, meaning three-eyed. And the third eye is called Shivanetra. Shiva and Shankara are thought to be one and the same. In that case, the third eye may be called Shankarnetra too, but never, because Shiva and Shankar are two different souls. Let's see the meanings of these Sanskrit words, Shankara and Shiva, the Shivanetra. Shankara is formed of two words, Sham or Shaman, plus Kara or Karoti. Sham means rest, equanimity, end, destruction, stop, easing, pacification. And we also know that Shankar is the destroyer, whereas Bhagavan is called the auspicious intellect or the beneficent, most auspicious one. The meaning of the word Shiva itself means auspicious incompleteness. Auspicious. The word Shiva in Sanskrit means kind, friendly, favorable, beneficent, pure, benignant, gracious, benign, harmless. Bliss is auspicious. And the word Netra means leader, the guide, river, flowing water of knowledge, conducting, guiding, leading. Hence, from the meaning of Shiva plus Netra, we understand that the Shiva is auspicious, beneficent, leader, who is the Panda, the guide, the leader, in the body of the Shankara. The Shiva Netra is also called as Surya Netra, as said in 19 of 11, and Jnana Netra, together meaning the only source of auspicious light of knowledge. The place between eyebrows is called Uttamang, chief part of the body, the seat of soul, which would mean that Shiva, the supreme wisdom, Buddhi, or the soul of Bhagavan, is seated in the Uttamang of Shankar, self-manifested by entering in the body of Shankar, as said in the verse 54 of chapter 11, by his own soul power, as mentioned in 6 of chapter 4, 7 of chapter 4, 8 and 9 of chapter 4. We also know that the Bhagavan sitting in the chariot of Arjuna teaches all the knowledge. The ultimate task of Arjuna is the destruction, and hence Shankar and Arjuna are same, one and the same. And the Bhagavan, who has occupied or self-manifested in his body in the place of soul, overpowering his intellect, is the auspicious Shiva. It is proven that Shiva is the god of Gita and Shankara is the bodily chariot of Shiva. Hence, the Omkarnath, the Swayambhu, the Jyotirlinga, the Vishwanath, the Mahadeva, Shiva is the god of the Gita. United we stand. He alone is the Satyam Shivam Sundaram, because he alone is the knower of the truth, and he is ever Sundaram, meaning ever pure, because he is ever unborn, and Shivam means ever auspicious. He is the incorporeal god of Gita. The picture of Rathi Sarathi, the Trinetri Shiva Shankar, and the Ardhanarishwar depict the same meaning, that Shiva self-manifested in the body of the Shankar is the God. Let us look at each of these pictures. The Rathi Sarathi, in this body like chariot, there are two souls that are figuratively shown. One soul is that of the owner of the body, Arjuna. However, the soul that is driving the bodily chariot is the intellect like co-charioteer called Saharathi, the driver, the supreme soul. Bhagavan's figure is shown in black, depiction of impurity. This is to show that the body Bhagavan has entered into is the impure body of Arjuna, whereas Bhagavan is a pure soul, which is depicted through the peacock feather and halo around the head, because the soul of the Bhagavan is located in the head of Arjuna. Now the next picture, Shiva Shankar. This is Shankar's body. The one who is leading his body is the soul of Shiva, depicted through the vertical third eye called Shiva Netra, meaning Shiva the leader. The owner of the body is shown in black, indicating the Shankara, the Arjuna, has become impure in his last Shudra birth of Kali Yuga. He is sitting in front of a Shivalinga, which is a depiction of he being immersed in the ocean of Shiva's knowledge, thinking, contemplating, and churning it. The picture of Ardhanarishvara. Here too, there is one body. The owner of the body, Shankar, is shown as nature. The earthly body called Prakriti in the feminine form, shown in black, depicting the impurity, whereas Shiva is shown in fair complexion, depicting his purity, and in masculine form called Purush. Purush means the power that is resting in the body like city. And this power is the Supreme Soul, the Gita Pati Bhagavan, and Arjuna is the Gita Mata. Here are the Gita verses for proving the picture of Ardhanarishvara being Arjuna and Shiva. Arjuna, meaning Shankara, is the Gita Mata, the mother nature, Kshetra, meaning the bodily field, or land, the motherland, Bharata, who is the Kurukshetra, meaning through whom the task of giving out knowledge is accomplished, where the Gita Pati Bhagavan, Shiva, sows the seed of knowledge, as said in 3 and 4 verse of chapter 14. He is the Ardhanarishvara, as said in 4 of 8. The Ardhanarishvara is combination of Arjuna, the soul of Arjuna, who has the body, Prakriti, the feminine form, mother-like, plus another soul, the Shiva, who is the Supreme Father. Thus, this singular form of father plus the mother, who are both together, the Param Brahma, the Supreme Teacher, in this verse from Pandava Gita, which means, you alone are the Mata, meaning the mother, you alone are the Pita, meaning the father, the Shiva, you alone are Bandhu and Sakha, meaning the relative and the friend, the only one to be remembered, and you alone are the wealth of knowledge, the Raja Vidya, and you alone are everything, my Deva Deva, the Mahadeva Shiva Shankar. So at the end of the Iron Age, we all humans must recognize this one bodily form of Supreme Soul for Supreme Father, and the Supreme Human Soul, who are together the teacher, the mother, the father, the only one to be remembered by all humans. We request the viewers to watch the three series and the episodes within the series in the numbered sequence. We have used questioning technique where each and every point is questioned, answered in the most practical manner, supported by religious scriptural references and other authentic evidences, and thus are arranged in logically meaningful flow.